Got me feeling like the elephant in every room I'm walking into. Yeah, we started out innocent till I got pulled right into your issue. Yeah, I'm tired.
All right, welcome everybody. Hello. All right, thank you for the wave. Hi, hi, hi. Okay, Melissa. Hey, 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 James in the back. Okay, so, okay, hopefully everybody's energy tonight is going to match my energy. Okay, we are here. Okay, Corey, you looking like you're not going to match my energy. I need you to liven up. Okay, you're one of the panelists tonight. I need you to liven up. Okay, all right. So I am so excited for today. This is our second team panel discussion. And so I am delighted to have some familiar faces joining us back. Hey, Shelly. Hey, Bree. We got some new faces. Okay, I forgot Sybil and Corey. Y'all oldies but goodies. Hey, y'all. Y'all is here. We have some new people joining us. And so I think Melissa, you ready? You got it?
I'm muted. We may need to... I'm having trouble with the live streaming, but we can just post it on our social media after the fact. It's trying to stream to my personal Facebook, not our agency Facebook.
That's okay. We'll just post it later.
We're recording
tonight. Okay, perfect. So we are recording for tonight. This will be posted on our social media platforms. Again, I want to thank everybody who accepted the invitation to come and join us on tonight. Melissa is going to be leading this panel discussion. Please send the invite out to, yes, it will keep that energy going all night, okay, till 7:30. That's what we're doing. Please invite your family and friends to join in on this discussion. We do have panelists that are going to be here, but this is open. So I'll be watching the chat, alerting Melissa when we have a question or we need clarity or whatever that may be. So for the panelists, relax, enjoy, have a good time. You're around familiar age people and probably some faces. And so with that being said, I'm going to turn it over to Melissa.
Thank you for that wonderful opening, Waukesha. Waukesha always gets everybody up and going. She's got that energy that we all need. I do want to thank everybody for joining us this evening. So I'm just going to go ahead and jump into it. Let me go ahead and introduce all of our panelists. Our first panelist to introduce is Corey Phillips. Corey currently serves as our Grants and Compliance Director at Bay Area Turning Point. Corey holds a master's degree in clinical mental health counseling with undergraduate work completed in psychology and sociology. During his studies, Corey began his career at Bay Area Turning Point and over 9 years of employment, Corey has worked in roles ranging from child care provider to counselor to grant writer. Corey is currently tasked with overseeing the program compliance portion at BATP, ensuring the technology needs are attended to, writing grants for private, state, and federal funding sources, providing a few hours a week of counseling. And Corey also holds a license as a licensed professional counselor associate with aspirations to acquire the prerequisite hours of practice to become fully licensed. When Corey is not fulfilling various roles at Bay Area Turning Point, he spends his time with his fiance, their daughter, and two dogs. Corey enjoys live music of all kinds, along with a love for playing and watching basketball in all of its forms. Please help me welcome Corey Phillips.
Hey, everybody. I need to rewrite that bio. Hey.
Next, we have Kadarius Wallace. Kadarius is a 13-year-old eighth grader attending, and I am so sorry if I mispronounce this. If I mispronounce it, please correct me. Stella Clawton Middle School in Spring IC. Did I say that right? Awesome. Yes. Okay. He's an amazing son and brother and likes sports. Kadarius' favorite hobby is riding horses. He has continuously accomplished A's and B's in schools with hopes to be a veterinarian or a vet tech. Please welcome Kadarius Wallace. Next, we have Shelly Parton, a second-time panelist who's a sophomore at Dickinson High School. Shelly is very involved with outside services and clubs, giving back to the community. She's also part of the awareness presentation team for younger students, presenting vital information pertaining to dealing with peer pressure, potential drug use, and sexual misconduct. She's in the Junior ROTC program, National High School Honor Society of Scholars. She's also a member of She Is More Than Enough Teen Outreach Program for Awareness, Building a Healthy Young Woman. Shelly is in the top of her class in technical welding, Kitty Hawk Society Honors for JROTC students. She participates actively in community service hours for Children's Center Incorporated in Galveston, Texas, and will be graduating class of 2024. Please welcome Shelly Parton. And welcome back, Shelly. Another panel veteran is Brianna Johnson, who is a senior at Alvin High School. She's the varsity cheer captain, a member of the National Honor Society, a member of Alvin ISD Superintendent Advisory Committee, and volunteer at Bay Area Turning Point. Brianna plans to attend Louisiana State University or Southern University and A&M College in the fall of 2022. Her hobbies include shopping, singing, and hanging with friends when she isn't working a part-time job at Main Squeeze or maintaining her GPA. She is the apple of her mother's eye, which happens to be Brenda Sykes, our very own executive director. Please welcome Brianna Johnson. Next, we have Journey Hutchinson, who is 13 years old. Journey is in the eighth grade and attends Knoll Middle School in Sheldon ISD. She loves to listen to music, and some of her favorite artists are Billie Eilish, Kehlani, Lauryn Hill, and SZA. Did I say that right?
I think it's SZA, Melissa. I'm cool. It's SZA. I'm cool.
I'm behind the time. Sorry. SZA. Okay. She also loves to watch scary movies to include The Conjuring, Texas Chainsaw Massacre, and The Nun. Journey has accomplished many things, but some of her biggest accomplishments are making the honor roll every year, getting accepted into student council on robotics, and taking high school credit classes in middle school. She has a passion to help others and always wanted to help people with mental health issues. Her future career goal is to work as a clinical psychologist. Working hard towards her goal and plans is to get accepted into early college high school. And with that, she can graduate with her associate's degree in behavioral science. Please welcome Journey Hutchinson. Thank you, Journey, for joining us today. Next, we have Narissa Chan. She's a junior at Clearbrook High School. She's always been interested in helping out the community behind the scenes, which includes mental health, which is why she would like to go into psychiatry in her future. She feels by gaining an understanding of how people work and how she can help others mentally or even save someone from a harmful situation, this will help prepare her for the future. Narissa plays tennis for Clearbrook High School. She loves to draw, write, and read. And she does welcome any book recommendations if anybody has them. Narissa is also a highly valued member of the Bay Area Turning Point Teen Dating Violence Awareness Month Committee that brings you this very panel discussion tonight. And last, but very certainly not least, we have Sybil Winters Little. Sybil is a graduate of Southern University and A&M College located in Baton Rouge, Louisiana. She graduated with honors, receiving a Bachelor of Science degree in psychology. In her leisure, she spends most of her time with her boys at sporting events, which she enjoys tremendously and would not trade for the world. Sybil's greatest accomplishment has been being a mom to two young men who have challenged her to live the expectation that she has given to them. Sybil became affiliated with Bay Area Turning Point in 1996, working as a resident advocate at the onset of the shelter opening. During her time with the agency, she has been afforded the opportunity to grow both professionally and personally, working in various positions within the agency. Currently, she is the operations director who is committed to assisting vulnerable populations with education and empowerment. Sybil's motto is, in order to make a change in society, it starts with you. Educating yourself and your children on societal inaccuracies is only the beginning. Sybil believes and strives to practice and promote fairness and equality for everyone through coaching, modeling, and leadership. So those are our panelists for this evening. Thank you all for joining us again. And let's go ahead and jump right in. So this is for Sybil and Corey both. Question number one. Were you allowed to
date? Wait, Melissa. Yeah. Let's kind of break it down with kind of what this panel discussion is going to be about tonight.
I guess that would help.
Yeah, just a little bit of insight on what we're talking about tonight.
Okay. So giving a little bit of insight on what we're going to be talking about. This panel discussion is for Teen Dating Violence Awareness Month, one of our activities that we decided to do. And what we wanted to do was get an adult and a teen perspective on how dating has changed. The dating cultures have changed throughout the years from whenever we were children to now. So this includes how peers have an effect on relationships and how social media and technology has had an impact on relationships. We're also going to talk about how to approach those conversations. And how do we make people comfortable with these conversations so that they are happening? So with that being said, now we can go ahead and get into the questions. Okay, so again, this is for Sybil and Corey. Were you allowed to date as a teenager? And if not, did you do it anyways?
Corey was a bad boy. I'm sure he did it. So, you know, I grew up in a very strict household. My dad, of course, apple of his eye, did not want me dating. And shamelessly, I will say, yes, I did sneak and date because everybody else was, and I didn't want to be the one not dating at the time, right? So all my girls had boyfriends, and I thought, this is crazy. My dad's just, you know, he's just mean. Doesn't want me to have fun. Don't want me to do anything and all of those things. But I will tell you that seriously dating, I did not do that until high school. My parents were very strict in the sense of they wanted me to be mature enough and at an age that I can handle the consequences that come with being in a dating relationship and also the rewards of being in a dating relationship. And so, I didn't have a whole lot of dating experience, Melissa, growing up. So that was my experience.
All right, Corey, spill it.
Well, unlike my fellow panelists here, I followed the rules that were laid out. So yes, my parents did allow me to date starting in middle school, and I did that. Much like Sybil, it wasn't any kind of serious, you know, long-term relationship or anything like that. But I mean, there was a pretty intense pressure to do that across the board, I think, when I was growing up, whether it was allowed or it wasn't, which I do want to reiterate that it was allowed, unlike others that didn't listen. I mean, my parents were pretty permissive when it came to that stuff. You know, probably could have gave me more guidance. That probably would have been helpful. But yeah, it was allowed and it was something I did. So.
Okay. So that, I kind of have a follow-up question to that for Sybil. What were your parents' reasoning behind not allowing you to date? And what were the conversations y'all had about that?
So I think their fear was with the teen dating that pregnancy would come of that I'd go too fast, too soon, wouldn't know how to handle things, just not mature enough, basically. They thought I was too immature to be doing that. And my dad would always say, you got the rest of your life to do all those things. And so just slow down, be a kid, enjoy life. You can wait for those things. Hindsight, he was right. He was right. I had the rest of my life to talk about, I want to date somebody, right? But I think as a parent today, my perspective might be a little different from my own boys. I did have an open dialogue of when's an appropriate age to date. We agreed ninth grade, you could start dating. My oldest stuck to it. My youngest did not. he's been doing this since eighth grade, he says, right? And so, but I also think that conversations were had about why and how and when, all those things about dating and what that looks like at a younger age. I did not have those conversations with my parents until I was high school. I've started having the conversation. I started having the conversation with my kids sooner than that. We started talking, as soon as they started talking about having this girl likes me, we started having the conversation. So for one of my children, it was, he was five. The other one, it was fifth grade. Yes, yes, yes. Shamelessly, he was five, right? All the girls like him, so.
I can only imagine which one that is. 5 years old.
Yes.
All right. So as we go through these questions, I am just going to kind of pick on y'all. So I'm just going to randomly choose somebody to answer the question. But if somebody does have an answer or wants to add on to somebody, or they think it's a really good question and just want to chime in as well, y'all feel free to. So next question. Brianna, I'm going to ask you this one. How do you think technology has impacted dating?
I think technology has impacted dating way more than probably what it used to be. I don't know. I wasn't alive during that time, so I wouldn't really know. But I think sometimes we set our expectations too high for our age. There's nothing wrong with treating a boy right, but you also have to, or them treating you right, but you also have to remember that sometimes these boys are kids themselves, just like we are kids. So just because you see celebrities posting about their gifts and what they get, like they get cars, flowers, or like big bouquet of flowers that cost a lot of money type things. And I think sometimes we forget as a generation the difference between grown people with money and who are stable versus kids who are barely just getting started. Some don't even work. So I feel like sometimes the expectations are a little too high for our age. Like we forget that we're young. It's not realistic for somebody to give you a car at 16, 17, 18. And it's not realistic for your parents to let you go out in a hotel and do certain things. Like especially with Valentine's Day, a lot of people were expecting stuff like that. And I'm like, what happened to teddy bears? I like teddy bears. Right. I wouldn't, I don't know. I think social media has really enhanced the way a generation thinks of gifts and all that stuff, like material things, rather than just celebrating with your partner.
Good, good, good. Corey, what's your take on it? How has technology, especially social media, impacted dating?
When I tell you that I am so excited that social media is not what it is today when I was that age, I mean that. Like just thinking of a relationship ending and then like imagine that person the next day posting pictures of other people. Like it's just a lot that goes into this that I just didn't have to deal with. And I'm glad that I didn't have to deal with. I mean, I'm not going to get on my soapbox and rant about social media like I want to, but what I will do is say that, you know, you look at research and stuff like that and over, you see that the stuff that people throw up on social media is the ideal kind of perfect or, you know, best version of themselves all the time. Is that people's realities? No, of course not. So when it comes to relationships, you have a lot of prying eyes and prying intentions from everyone around you that can constantly see into your lives. And when that's between two people, I mean, that can create a big rift. It can create a ton of issues. So social media is a good tool for certain things, but when it comes to like intimate relationships and stuff like that, the opinions of your 500 followers tends to play a role when it shouldn't. So, I mean, I think it plays a huge role in dating relationships today. And I think we probably need to get a better handle on it, but I mean, for where things are now, yeah, I'd say it's pretty big, big deal.
So this next one is going to be for Sybil and Narissa, and I will let y'all decide who goes first. What are the benefits of couples posting themselves online, and what are the risks of having a public dating relationship? So benefits and risks of having a publicly or online public relationship.
Okay, I'll go first. I think the benefits of this type of like relationship is that like there's more security, I would say, like seeing, like having like a response and like kind of a comfort that, oh, you know, people can see my like my relationship, and like I think there's some sort of like validation that comes with it. I think because people want to show off their like partner, and they want to show off like, oh, look how happy we are. And like, it's good. It's a good thing. But then also I feel like it can get really toxic and like unhealthy if it gets taken too far, because I think especially in this day and age, whenever technology is so important, like if this kind of image will reflect poorly if like other people see it, and then they get insecure about their own like relationship, and just causes like problems that, you know, initially were not there. And I also think that like this kind of pressure to uphold this like image is also really toxic, because I think like it'll just ruin whatever you have going on, because it's, you're like, the people in the relationship want to show off their like the best side of them, even if it's not like the truth. So it just makes things worse, I think, for everybody.
So what's your take on it?
You know, I don't know if there's anything left to be said. Narissa said it well. You know, there are some benefits, but I think there's more risks at posting relationships on social media than there are benefits. And so if you have a relationship that's not in a healthy space, then you run the risk of it causing more concerns or issues. You know, I think the beauty in posting relationships on social media is you're able to show the world that there is true love in the world, right? But you also have to be prepared for everyone else to have comments or opinions or thoughts, and be willing to share that on your social media of what they think about your relationship. And God bless America, if you decide to break up with that person, then everybody is a part of the breakup and has something to say and to share and all of those things. And so I certainly believe that social media is, you know, technology in general is, it's our friend and our foe. If it's used appropriately, it can help us. If it's used, you know, inappropriately, then it can harm us and others. So Narissa, you were right on target. Thank you.
All right, next one. Journey, do you believe toxic relationships are romanticized online? So looking at like celebrity couples or peers on social media, do you think that this is becoming the norm?
Yes. I don't know where they got that from, but yes. And it's not even just like older people, it's younger people too. Like even people in my school, like I've seen it, like people will come to me and tell me about it. And I'm just like, that's not okay. But it definitely is romanticized, because a lot of people want it, but nobody actually needs it. So yeah.
Good. Awesome. Next question. I think we've already kind of answered the next one that I actually, no, I'm gonna go ahead and ask this one, because I know we've touched on social media, but I want to get the perspective from Corey and Kadarius on this. How do you feel social media, or not just social media, but technology in general, how do you think dating has changed with the changes in technology from Corey, whenever you were a kid, to now?
Kadarius, you want to go first? You want me to go first?
I insist you go first.
All right. So, I mean, me and Kadarius, we're about the same age. You know, we're both pretty young individuals. So I'll try to speak to the adult perspective as best I can. But the way technology was when I was a kid versus where it is now, it's everything just ramped up. Like you're much more connected 24/7 to everything, right? Like you talked about your relationship kind of being under fire. That's all day. That's 3 a.m. Someone has something to say somewhere, right? So I think the biggest thing is just being constantly connected to the world, no matter across the board, whether it's relationships, social media, all of it. And I think the tie-in from things like pop culture, what we listen to, music, things on TV, like you talk about toxic relationships and all that stuff is built into it. I mean, how many songs have you heard where if you weren't around me, I would die? Well, you wouldn't. You may be sad. Yeah, I can get that, but you're not going to physically stop breathing if we're no longer together. Like, I'm sorry that maybe isn't very romantic for you to hear, but that's kind of how the human body works. So I think technology and just how everything is interconnected, all of that stuff is all wound up together. And since we're always, you know, 24/7 onto everything, I could definitely see that being a bigger issue today than it was just 2 years ago when I was a teenager. Waukesha, fix your face.
What do you think?
Honest conversation, Melissa.
Do what?
I thought this was going to be an honest conversation.
I'm trying to stay neutral here. Corey, you're making it hard. You're making it very hard to be neutral. Okay. Kadarius, what's your take on it? I mean, I know everybody's kind of chimed in on how they feel technology has impacted dating, but from your perspective, how do you think it's impacted it?
I feel as if, like, with the technology and how people date nowadays online, like, some people feel immune to, like, they, as if they want to have a toxic relationship, and I feel as if, like, as far as the breakups and stuff, like, they have to be prepared for, like, all the opinions online and how other people feel about it. And they will have to sort of come to an agreement as if, like, how they feel together as, like, in a relationship. But as far as, like, social media, that's as much as I can, like, put on top of it.
Thank you. Good answer. Okay, so kind of getting away from social media for a minute and moving on to the next topic. Shelly, this one's for you. If parents forbid a teen from dating, how do you think that teen's going to react?
Well, my parents forbidden me to date until 16, which I'm actually I would love to do now. But most of my friends, when their parents tell them they can't, they go behind the back and they do it because they want to be able to have freedom since they are in high school. But their parent, what they don't understand is that their parent knows better and that their parent knows that they're not matured enough for it.
So that being said, and I'm going to go to Brianna on this one. What are the expectations in dating at y'all's age? And I'm going to open this up to all the teens on the panel. What expectations do you see? Because I know all of you kind of are in different areas and it kind of changes from area to area. So what are some of the expectations you see as far as dating?
For what I see a lot of the expectations I see come from social media. Like we'll have the basics, like they should treat you with respect and talk to you nicely and be kind. But a lot of the stuff I see a lot of material things wise on social media and how they don't show the negative sides of relationships. And if they do, they're romanticizing the toxic ones. And so it's almost like you're, it's like if something were to go wrong in your relationship, it's like immediately, oh, you need to break up with him or he's not the one for you, or you're in a toxic relationship and it's like, y'all are gonna get back together anyways. It doesn't matter. It's one or the other. and they don't romanticize about how to deal with little things, that mistakes you make along the way in dating. Nobody talks about that, and you just expect it to be kind of like a perfect couple. We buy each other things, more so the males than the females, but I believe it's always been that way. But yeah, that's more the expectations for dating that I see.
Journey, what's your take on it? What are the expectations in dating at your age?
Well, they're not really much because of the people that, you know, the people that you see all the time. But mine is, you know, the basics, like respectful and honest. But, you know, you can't really get that because of how old we are. I'm only 13 and the people around me are what, 14 and 15? And you can't really expect much because they're not mature. Just because I'm more mature than them doesn't mean that I'm fully mature, and neither are they. So you can't really expect much.
That is an excellent, excellent, honest answer. Thank you. Narissa, what you got?
I'm not like, okay, in my like friend group, I don't think there's necessarily like any expectations, but I do think that like there's a lot of expectations in the like the relationship that needs to be talked out. Like one of my friends, so she was dating this guy, and like before the relationship actually like began, she was like, okay, she said boundaries, which is just like great, right? But she put it as like more like, so she said that she did not want to be like physically touched or anything like that, like not until she was comfortable, which is like great, that's fine. And he listened, but then they broke up because she was like, oh yeah, he didn't like act on anything. And then the poor guy was like, what? Like, you told me like not to do this and like whatnot. So I think that there needs to be some sort of communication, like especially like just make sure that like you talk everything out, and make sure that if you change your expectations of what like your relationship should be, definitely communicate it like with your partner.
Darius, what's your take on it? What are the expectations of dating at your age?
Well, from what I see, I feel as if like kids nowadays, they feel as if they want their relationship to be perfect, when we know that it's not going to be perfect unless you are building communication. And so like I feel as if like if you can build your trust within like within each other, and you communicate more, you will be able to meet your standards as of what both of you expect within the relationship.
Awesome. All right, and Shelly, what's your take?
Well, the expectations really, since
I haven't really started dating yet at all, but expectations nowadays, kind of like what Brianna said, they do base them a lot off social media and stars they see and people that they try to look up to. But my expectations personally, I want to know if they're going to respect me. I want to know if they have anything that possibly could end up ruining this, like red flags along the way. I don't want to be in a relationship where I honestly cannot trust you. If you are sneaking around behind my back and not wanting to be honest with me, I can't do it.
Yeah. Trust is definitely one of the key things for having a relationship with somebody.
So Melissa, we have a couple of comments in the chat that I'll read out.
Okay.
One was coming from Reconnecting. And I think that some of our clients that are also joining us today. And so it's, tech can be both a good and bad, depends on how you use it while dating. So that's a good one, true. And then we have Brenda Sykes says society, social media, media, et cetera, pushes unhealthy relationships, and there are not resources to address what healthy relationships look like outside of the home, which I think is very key. I think we get so caught up in being closed-minded or closed-mouthed about dating with our kids. And so we don't talk about what that looks like outside of the father, son, mother, daughter, those type of relationships. So yeah, I think you bring up a really good point, Brenda, that we don't expand outside of the normal family type of relationship.
Keisha, if I can add, you know, I'm really impressed with the panelists and their answers, the teams. And in my mind, I think, gosh, I wish I had friends like you guys to help me stay, you know, on the straight and narrow and clear and have some expectations or just someone to talk to. You guys are really bringing the information to us. And my hopes are is that you're also bringing it to your friends.
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. Okay, so kind of digging in a little deeper into what this could possibly look like. Let's see. Brianna, how can you tell if someone just admires you or if they are dangerously possessive? And where do you draw that line?
Well, I have a personality where there's like
Mom. I thought I was on mute.
Sorry, go ahead,
Brittany. Me personally, I have a personality just like my mom. I don't like for nobody to tell me what I can and not do. So I choose not to be very possessive over people, and I don't let people be possessive over me because you're not gonna tell me what to do. I don't like that personally. So the difference is when somebody's being possessive, they always want to know where you're at, where you're going, or trying to control what you do instead of just letting you go off and them trusting you to do your own things. They want to always know what's in your phone. They want to know where your location is, but not for safety purposes, more for so they can track you, follow you, and be like, where are you? Why are you here? And they try to drift you away from like your family, friends. And that's the difference between being possessive and just being concerned, I guess you could say. Like there's no way, at least at our in my age, in my opinion, or when I get grown, I don't believe somebody should always be around you as a couple. Like I'm clingy, but not clingy at the same time. So I don't like for people to be all up on me and know too much, especially with boys, because, or whoever you date, really, it's not just to males. Because it's just, it comes off as abusive rather than, because the way my head thinks, I believe that if you're possessive and you're trying to control me, you're hiding something so I won't find out. You're trying to limit my mind and what I think.
Excellent answer. Corey, this one's for you. How does mental health play a role in dating?
A huge one. the golden rule for dating for myself, and especially like when I'm working with clients and stuff, is that and kind of touching almost on what Brianna said there, a relationship is supposed to add something to your life, right? Like too often when we think about these abusive, controlling relationships, it's removing things. Oh, I can't be friends with these people. I can't do these certain things because of the person that I'm with. So anytime that it's taking something away, that's where you see that kind of controlling behavior come in. But where you start from kind of can dictate where the relationship goes. So, you know, whatever it is that you're dealing with, anxiety, depression, any underlying anything, right? Anything that you have going on in life makes us better or not as equipped to kind of take on a relationship, right? Like over and over again, when you see people that give advice on relationships, when you get out of them, the advice is, well, work on yourself and then get back out there. well, if you never do that part, right, we never do the work to kind of do our part, whatever that is, work on whatever it is that's going on with us, we take that to the next relationship. And the next person that we date kind of has to deal with the baggage of the last person because we didn't deal with those things. So the main thing that I try to stress, I mean, because I'll be honest, guys, like, especially to you teens, I meet with about 10 clients a week, and I'd say 80-90% of them, I talk about relationships with them. So yeah, we're coming from different ages. Well, not me, I'm y'all's age, but the rest of the people on here, you know, clearly much older than myself. And they, we're all kind of doing the same things, we're just doing them at different ages. Like, we're older than you guys, so we have more experience kind of not doing it right. And that's why we have the information to give you guys. So, but as far as mental health is concerned, do the work. Okay, Brenda, somebody get Brenda out of the chat. But do the work on yourself and then make sure that you're really ready to undertake something like that first, because it is someone else's, you know, well-being built up in that. So make sure that you're ready for that and for what that means for them.
Thank you. Aside from lying about your age, we're trying to teach these teenagers how to be honest, Corey.
It's the question in the chat. It's the question in the chat for Corey. So Corey, what are some things, so you said working on yourself, right? So what are some things that teens can work on regarding themselves before saying, "Ooh, it's time for me to get a boo"? What can they do in preparation for that?
What can they do to get a boo? So
that's not what I said.
Okay, okay. Anyway, sorry. I mean, to me, Waukesha, and this is kind of my personal feelings on it, and then obviously some of the schooling that I've done, but, you know, getting into a relationship is not a way to build self-esteem, right? It's not someone else's responsibility for you to feel better about yourself, right? Like, this person does not validate me. It's up to me to build that within myself and to feel comfortable in that. So the main thing that I would kind of stress is the importance of building your own sense of self-esteem and being comfortable being with yourself. Like Brianna mentioned, I think that's how people get tied up in these things where they feel like they need to be with their partner 24/7 is because they're not comfortable being with themselves. Like, you have to, at the end of the day, it's you, right? You're in here, and you have to be in a place where that's okay, right? Like, you're not looking for someone else to fix that for you. Get it to where you're comfortable with it on your own, and then take that to them. So, good question, though.
Excellent question. Okay, Sybil, many teens and parents feel there needs to be a balance whenever it comes to dating. So teenagers and young adults can't learn from their mistakes if they aren't allowed the freedom to make them. However, at what point as a parent do you step in?
So, you know, that's a really, really good topic. We probably could go on for hours on that. And I think it is, I think it's individualizing it, right? Each child is going to be different. Each person is going to be different. So sometimes you have to individualize what that person can handle. And as parents, we know our kids, even though they think we don't, even though they think we're not listening, even though they think we're not interested or invested, we know our kids and what they can handle. And so, you know, there is a balance. You know, when I see my Zion running off and he wants to spend all his time with a certain individual, you know, we have to have a conversation about that because I also don't want him to lose himself. And not make his priorities still his priorities because he's investing all his time in someone else. And so we have those conversations. So I think open dialogue, communication, several of our young panelists said that that's what is about a relationship. And I think in a parenting relationship, it's just as important to have those conversations with your kids. And so for me, it's like when I see, you know, Zion steering off in one direction, you know, I want to have the conversation so I can pull him back in the other direction. We have a conversation about it. Like, you know, why is it you want to spend all your time with, you know, your boo? Why, you know, why you want to spend your time with your mama? Okay, I'm important too, right? No, but we want to have those conversations, right? And so he can tell me why he's going in that direction versus me assuming it, but also then me being willing to say, well, you know, this is what I think you should do, or this is what I think you need to do. And at a certain age, Melissa, you do have to step back and allow them to make the mistakes. But I can tell you guys, it is heartbreaking as a parent to see your child cry or be heartbroken or be upset or to be angry
And so we try to do everything we can to protect you. And sometimes we can go overboard. You know, some of us are helicopter moms. I won't call any names. But, you know, sometimes, you know, we might go overboard with trying to protect our kids. But that's really what it's about. We want to protect you. We love you so much. We want the best for you. And so all of our annoying advice is for that. All of our helicopter hovering is for that, because we love you and we want the best. And so again, communication is key in any relationship. And so just as parent-child, it's important. And the two of you have to talk about what does that balance look like for that individual.
Okay, can I piggyback off of that? I'm gonna ask for two people. Two teens. Oh wait, well, since you put Brenda out there, Brianna, one of them is gonna be for you. And then the other one, I'm gonna ask Narissa. So what's the difference? What do you all feel become the, I'm gonna say cross the line of helicopter parent and I'm receiving your protective guidance and advice? Like, where's that boundary with parents? Because I think we think at five, my daughter's five, and I'm always thinking I'm in protection mode, not helicopter. So where does it become the distinction for a teen and you receiving it? Because it's really our intent for you to receive it as protection. But when is it that you're going to write, like you right there, mama, you need to back on up. What it look like?
I would say it looks like they're being helicopter parents when it becomes, when you notice other people are changing around you in the way their parents let them go do things and you're not, basically. When you see other parents are trying to slowly let go, like for my age, since I'm about to go to college soon, a lot of parents are letting, like, they're not as, give me your phone, let me see it, everything, because they know they can't do that. That's not realistically what happens in college. And for me, I knew I had to have a talk with my mom when she wanted to, this is her car. I want y'all to know that this is her car, I'm just driving it. When she wanted to know the exact places, exactly who was in the car, how far we're gonna drive, and she uses this app to control everything in my car so much. I go 1 mile over the speed limit, she's like, slow down. As if a car is not, like, literally finna rear end me. Like, it's different when you're on the road. Sometimes you just have to go a little over. That's just how it is. But,
okay, they asked you what was your, what's the line? They asked that question. All right.
I think the line is when you sense your child is in a dangerous situation, I mean a real situation, not just, I feel a little uneasy because I'm not used to them going out so much. It's more of a really, like, I just want you to know. It's kind of like suggesting instead of being like, no, and let me see this and why, where, who. I mean, it's realistically to ask where, but when your parent starts to want to control, almost like she wants to be there, but not really. She wants to have as much eyes on everything as she can. And the moment she sees anything in danger, but when you go out, there's going to be danger everywhere. You're just going to see some things as you grow up. And you're as a parent, you probably don't want your child to see things. Like, you don't want your kids to be around people who do things like, I guess, drink, all that stuff underage. But realistically, that's what people do. Like, it's very common for people to do illegal things, but it's not really talked about as much because it's kind of like an underground thing, but not really. But when your parent starts to want to almost like be there instead of just trusting your kid and letting her experience things, because at the end of the day, everybody is unique because of their story. Everybody's going to make mistakes. But when you sense something about to be like a big one, like teen pregnancy, I would say that's a really big one where your parent has to step in and be like, okay, like notify you on precautions you can take to avoid it, stuff like that. Because as you get older, it's kind of taboo to talk about. Everybody's like, wait till marriage, wait till you find the one. But realistically, that's not how it works, especially when you go off to college and nobody kind of really talks about it that much to their kids. But I would say my mom talks to me about it. But the difference between precaution and helicoptering is when they'd be like, you can't go over to this person's house at all, or is who and so going to be there? Or I would even say pulling up to that person's house just to see and send me a picture of you at this person's house, or blase, blase. And the difference is with precaution, you talk to them and be like, hey, doing adult things such as sex causes soul ties. You can get STDs, all that stuff. So that's the difference between helicopter and just precaution, just notifying your child and communicating with them the dangers of why you feel uneasy as a parent.
So the conversation is what distinguished from being a helicopter. Okay, so when we don't go into, here's the why. So I guess the why behind it. So when we give the straight, hard, and fast, I say no, drop the keys, you're done. Then that's the helicopter versus explaining what that is. So parents, we hear that, we gotta explain. When I know as parents, we get to the point of, I bought the car, the gas, the clothes. I gave you the $5 to get into the movie. We go down the list of what we've done. And so it becomes a sense of entitlement. Okay, you laughing, Sharon, this sounding familiar. You get caught up in the entitlement as a parent. But I want you guys to hear straight from the mouth of a teen. They understand that we want to protect them. But just as when we're on a job and we want to know why you want me to do this, why I got to do that, why this, why. Our kids sometimes deserve that same courtesy of us just taking the time to explain the why behind it. I think we have a great group of kids on here, and I think it's even more who aren't here that can understand the reasoning and the rationale. I think they absolutely can. So thank you, Bree, for wrapping that up for us. I appreciate it. Okay, Melissa, we're gonna jump on to the next one.
Okay, did you want Narissa to answer?
No, I think, Narissa, did you have something to add?
Not really. She kind of covered everything.
Okay.
Okay. All right. This next one is for Journey and Kadarius. How do you think peer pressure affects dating amongst young people? Because I know at y'all's age, that's whenever that peer pressure starts pretty hard.
What was the question again, Melissa?
How does peer pressure affect dating amongst young people?
Okay, for peer pressure, I think there's a lot of good and bad with this, because like people in like a relationship with peer pressure, people can like kind of influence the others depending on like, oh, like let's say a friend comes up and is like, hey, like, I don't think your like significant other is that great. And like, you kind of talk it out and realize, oh, maybe they're not fit for me, you know? And that realization might not be able to happen without like that other person there. But also I think peer pressure is kind of bad, because I feel like people in like relationships, a lot of people like feel like they have to get together because everybody else is like, oh, like you guys would be like perfect together, whenever in reality, like you don't want to be in like that relationship, but because you feel as if there's like this expectation from others, it just kind of backfires on you. And then you kind of feel like, okay, maybe like if I just try it out, it'll be fine. But then like, it's not fine, because you realize, oh, like, I don't like this person at all. So I think that although like there are some positives to it, I don't think it's like necessarily peer pressure, because like that's more like, oh, hey, like acknowledgement. But in this case, I think it's not that great for, yeah.
Good answer. Journey, what's your take on it?
And I was going to say, because Journey and Kadarius, y'all are middle school teens. So what does I think Narissa, Bree, and Shelly, they're high school. So what does that, I was going to ask, what does that look like? Peer pressure at 13 in middle school. What does that peer pressure look? Because I'm sure it's different from when even Bree and Narissa and Shelly were 13.
I know it's happening at 13 because I work in the middle schools and I see it happen all the time.
So peer pressure is a really powerful thing. A lot of people at my school are dating and some are not, which would include me. A lot of them are dating and like just all kinds of things, but even though you're like, okay, that's your friend. Okay, they do what they want. But then when they try to get you to do it, it's another thing. And it makes me like bothered because why are you pressuring somebody into doing something that you know is not right? I know it's not right. So why are we doing, why are you doing it and try to get me to do it? Thank you.
That's an excellent answer. Kadarius, what you got?
So I feel as if like people try to be more convincing and they want you to feel happy and they want to do, sometimes people want you to do what they can't do, or like as far as peer pressure, like they feel as if like if you were to go out and date, you will feel better, that's not always the case, because there's other things you can do which could help you feel better or keep you busy. And another thing is that like some people will try to come in between a relationship and that will cause chaos sometimes. And as far as the chaos, that will start making like some people's relationships go downhill as far as how they feel with each other and how they come in between each other.
Yeah, absolutely. Excellent answer. Okay, next question. Shelly, I think I asked you previously about dating expectations. Do you feel any discomfort in some of the expectations of dating at your age?
Yes. Most of my friends, they're dating and, well, they want to start their relationship off really, really fast, yet they just met each other. And I'm sorry, but I'm one of those people, I want to know the person I want to be with before I get with them.
Like, if we're friends and then we end up in a relationship, fine. But I don't want to rush into something where I don't know you and then we're dating and I find out completely and honestly, I don't have anything in common with you and we never are going to get along. And that also goes along with peer pressure. If your friends are like pressuring you to do something, you might end up doing it and then you feel unhappy.
Excellent. And that actually leads me into the next question, which is if you are dating somebody that wants to move faster with you than you, how do you handle it?
I haven't dated anyone, but I've had people who have come at me. And I honestly, what I do, I walk straight to my honest and true friends and they start leaving me alone because they know that my friends are always have my back. My friends are always there for me. They always will protect me and they will always help me through anything. So they know not to do that kind of things to me. And if I do end up in a relationship like that, I'm sorry, I'm going to be completely honest with the person and tell them I do not feel comfortable with that.
Yeah, you got to establish those boundaries. Yeah, excellent answer. Thank you. Okay, next question
is for the adults. And then, so I'm going to get y'all's take on this. And then the last several questions are going to be for the teenagers on the call. And that part is going to be very important for all the parents on the call to listen to. And of course, at the end, we're going to take questions or comments. So for Sybil and Corey, I know your daughter's not a teenager yet, but I know you're already plotting these conversations. So what are some of the conversations you have with your teen about dating or plan to have with your teen about dating?
Cora, before you quickly answer what you and Cora are talking about at the house, Bree has to jump off. And so I wanted us to give her a warm thank you for joining us. I think she got to get on back in there to work.
Thank you so much, Bree, for being on today.
Thank you so much. We appreciate you. Good luck in choosing where you go off to school, and please keep us posted on your graduation plans so that we can continue to support you on your journey. Thank you.
Thanks. Bye. Bye.
All right. So, no, my daughter's not dating at 6, but I hope. But her backpack was full of like some letters that they're writing to each other. I don't know that they can't really write that well. I don't really know what it was about, but it was about these 2 6-year-olds that are apparently together, per her words. I don't know. She's 6. But anyways, I say all that to say that the most important thing to me with Cora is that she starts building kind of the way that she goes into these relationships, whether it's romantic, friendship, anything, in a healthy manner, right? Like a way that she gets fulfillment of, and that, you know, respectful, all that great stuff. So while we're not necessarily talking about dating, we do talk about how her friends treat her and how, you know, does she enjoy what that's like, and, you know, what do good friendships look like and things like that. Because to me, I mean, romantic relationships are not that different from peer relationships, honestly. I mean, you know, you add in some of the romantic components, but the basics of you want to enjoy this person, kind of like Shelley said, enjoy being around them, like that kind of stuff, that's all there. So from a young age, I wanted to build those skills and be firm in setting boundaries with people that maybe she doesn't get along with, or that, you know, well, we're in the same class together, so we have to get along together. Well, if you don't treat me right, not necessarily, right? Like, mm-hmm. Just because we share a space. So, just the main thing being that I established from a young age what is okay for her and what isn't okay for her. Her words, the way that she develops them, what she's comfortable with, in relationships across the board, hoping that she carries that into our romantic relationships that I'm super looking forward to in the future.
Thank you. So, well, I think you've kind of touched on it a little bit, but I'm gonna let you kind of chime in on the conversations you've had.
So, you know, ironically, my boys have been pretty open talking to me. Sometimes I don't want to talk about the things they want to talk about. And I have to get an understanding of some of the lingo. You know, Zion said something to me the other day and I was like, what does that mean? He's like, we just messing around. You don't tell your mama you're just messing around with somebody. And so I said, what does that mean? He was like, mama, it's the new word for dating. I said, well, it don't sound good to me. Cause messing around back in the day was messing around, right? Doing things that your mama told you not to do. And so I think that having conversations, also as Waukesha and Corey seem to believe they're so young, keeping up with their terminology, what do things mean, and being willing to go there, being willing to understand those things. But, you know, I started talking to my boys early on. What was really important to me is that as young men, they understood what no meant. So I've used the terminology no means no from beginning. Like, when I say no, it means no, because I want them to hear that when others say that. When their girlfriend tells them no, I want them to hear that and respect that. And then the other thing that we talk about is you teach people how to love and treat you. And so you can't expect people to love you a certain way that you have expectations of if you've not told them that or you've not taught them that. And once they cross that line, across that boundary, you're having a conversation. If they repeat it, then you make a decision what's in the best interest for you in that relationship. And so, you know, having conversations, Melissa, whether I wanted to have them or not. My boys, you know, they want to know the female perspective. Well, mom, if I do this, what does that mean? You know, what is a girl going to think? And I'm just like, okay, can you have that conversation with your dad? But, you know, they want to, I've been fortunate that my boys have wanted to have conversations with me, and their friends too, their guy friends too, want to have a conversation with me. So I've been a part of those discussions, and I've had to get comfortable. And I think sometimes as parents, we don't want to have those conversations because we really don't want to know some things. Like if you're doing those things that we've asked you not to, we really don't want to know it because then we have to deal with it, right? And so as parents, sometimes we don't have those conversations because, you know, those are taboo, or we don't talk about those things. We don't do those things. Certainly you're not going to tell me that you're doing those things because then I have to be a parent and deal with those things. So.
Thank you. So that kind of just leads me into a follow-up question. Do you think it's the responsibility of the parents or schools to be teaching this stuff about healthy relationships, healthy dating?
It takes a village, but it starts at home. That's my two cents.
I agree. I think you start that at a young age. And I mean, the more messages we can get from across the board, I think the better. But I mean, you as the parent, you start the foundation. So.
Okay. So the last couple of questions are for the teenage panelists. Question number one. What are some things that you would like for your parents to tell you about dating? Let's start with Narissa.
I don't think that there's anything necessarily like that I want to be heard, but I think like if I were to be in a relationship, I want to be able to be comfortable in asking anything that like under the sun without like judgment. I think that as long as you're open to like answering these type of questions, like teenagers will be more willing to share this type of like this part of their life with you. So I think that's it.
Yeah. All right, Shelly, what about you? What are some things you want your parents to tell you about dating?
Well, me and my grandmother, honestly, we talk about pretty much anything. I usually don't start the conversation, but as soon as she does, I'm honest with her. I tell her the complete and honest truth. She tells me, like, if I tell her something and she gives me her opinion on it, it's usually, oh, this guy, I told her, like, I don't mind, but I told her that some guy told me that I needed to shut my mouth and I needed to keep it shut because it's been like that for over 300 years. And I told her that, and she was like, oh, he might like you, but that's a warning sign that you should not be around him. I was like, honestly, I don't even know why he's talking to me. He was getting upset because I got a better weld than he did on class. I don't know why we have to get upset over a little weld, but honestly, my grandma gives me tips on how I need to dress to be treated respectfully, how I need to act to be treated respectfully, how I need to treat others, and what to see in someone in order to know that I don't need to be around them or if I feel comfortable around them.
Thank you. All right, Journey, what about you?
There's not really much because I don't date, but if I did, it would probably be just to, like, I guess choosing the right person, maybe, or if it's not the right person, how to know if they're not the right person. And also just how I should be treated and should not be treated and stuff like that.
Excellent. And what about you, Kadarius?
Like as they said,
speak up.
As they said, not much on that, but like I feel as if I could ask my parents how they feel if I were to be in a relationship, as far as how they feel about the other person and what they feel we could do to better our relationship and to make things right for each other.
Awesome. Okay, next question. How can parents make teens more comfortable being open about dating? From the teenage perspective, how can your parents make you feel comfortable talking to them about this?
Well, honestly, I believe it's communication. You build that from a young age, telling them, but then also a judgment-free zone. I'm sorry. But if you judge them while they're talking to you, they don't feel like they can be open with you at all. They don't feel like they can communicate with you and they feel like they have to keep it from you, which can be worse on the kid than you think.
Excellent. Yes, absolutely.
Melissa,
all right, Narissa, what do you think? Sorry, go ahead.
Melissa, we have a comment from Reconnecting to Everyone saying, being kind when they speak. I'm assuming when parents are speaking to the child, being kind when they speak.
The tone that you use has a lot to do with it. Narissa, what's your take on it? How can parents make teens feel more comfortable about being open about dating?
Jumping on Shelly's response, I agree. I think that judgment is like the biggest factor because, I think that whenever parents are like overbearing or like they try, like obviously it's not their intention to be like harmful or make it feel like it's not okay. But I think that that kind of response will reflect on the teen in a poor way. And like, cause like they're super vulnerable. They're like, you know, telling you stuff that like, is not really, it's like deep in like their heart, like they care about it a lot. And I think that like, as long as you're accepting and you're open to listen like about anything and then kind of keep in mind of what you say and like your reactions and responses, because I think especially like teens pay attention to that. And as long as you, you know, just keep an open mind and like really be honest and like have constructive criticism. Don't just like criticize harshly or like just be very gentle, I think. And then like, I think just communicate. And I think that's really it.
Thank you. Kadarius, what do you think? How can parents make teens feel more comfortable about being open about talking about dating?
I think that like they could be more careful or considerate as like when it comes to the judgment as of how they feel toward somebody's relationship or how they would like to date. And I feel as if like they should, sometimes they will have to let the child decide on, make better decisions on their own. And sometimes they will have to let the child feel more comfortable and they will have to, how do I say this? They will have to be like, they'll have to accept a child's decision with their relationship.
Excellent answer. Thank you. All right, Journey, what's your take on it?
I think that parents don't need to be so harsh and down your throat, especially when you don't know. I think when you don't know, it's not good for somebody to just judge you so much because you don't know. How are you going to learn when somebody's constantly like putting you down? So I just think that, like they said, the tone of voice and just how you talk to someone in general, you just have to work on that.
Thank you. Brenda, I think we have a couple of comments in the chat. I haven't seen what they are, but.
Yeah, so we have a parent that's basically saying, Janique McCray, that she's working on something referenced in the conversation with her 10-year-old son, and that that's a good point, the tone of voice, that she's also working on that. So I think as parents, we can acknowledge sometimes just the stresses of life or work, or maybe the mood that we're in, sometimes it comes across when we're speaking to our children, and we just have to be mindful of that. And I think as parents, while I'll speak for me, sometimes the fear kind of drives some of those, that tone and that deliverance. We also have a comment from Reconnecting, judging can hurt the child long-term. We want validation. And so our teens are asking us to validate, to listen, to hear them, and to validate what they're feeling. And then Angel Jennings made a comment, shout out to all the teams for your honesty and your willingness to share your true thoughts and not feeling you're being judged. You are all magnificent. Magnificent.
That has happened to me before.
I don't know why. Super champs in my book, right? And then we just have people acknowledging and validating the feelings that are, the comments that are being stated by the panelists. So that's it.
All right, I got one last question. How can your parents help you learn to set boundaries? And let's start with Journey on this one. Sorry, I know you just went, but.
Do you mind repeating the question, please?
Yeah, how can your parents help you learn to set boundaries?
Just kind of telling them stuff that you feel is not right, and then they can kind of help you on how to set those boundaries, so that way nobody will ever do it to you again, or just feel like they can and feel like they can just do you however. So
thank you. Darius, what about you? How can your parents help you learn to set boundaries?
I think parents can start off by helping, set boundaries by letting you know like how to deal with situations, such as like the way your partner feels about your relationship, and giving their honest opinion on the ways you both can agree to how you want to better your relationship, and how should I say this? I'm not sure how to get this out. But.
Thank you. If you think of it, just stop us and let us know. Shelly, what about you?
Well, they can help us set boundaries by like telling us about their own experiences. My grandma has told me a lot about what she's gone through, so that helps me learn, hey, somebody already did this part and it didn't work out so well for them. I'm going to try to prevent it from happening with me. But telling us about red flags and how we need to trust our instincts on people. It does help you set boundaries between others, whether it's a relationship with dating or just with friends, because either way, you have to build a bond. You have to be able to put boundaries between it.
Thank you. And Arissa.
I think this depends on the situation. Like, I think parents, like, I'm trying to think how to say this. Okay, so like, parents, I think, should always give like helpful advice if needed, if like the teens, like a teen would come up and like ask them about something. But depending on how severe the situation is or how like how much help this like their child needs, I think that the parents should be involved a little bit, like not just with advice, but to like actually like step in. However, this doesn't mean that like a parent can go in and like kind of mess up the like relationship or like whatever is happening like with boundaries. Because I feel like, again, as I said before, it's kind of controlling and they feel like the teen would be kind of trapped. I think this has to be like discussed between the parent and the teen. And as long as like there's communication, like I said before, it'll all work out.
Excellent. Thank you.
We have a couple comments in the chat. So Galaxy Tab S7, be nice and open to children and give them a chance. Reconnecting parents can help to get us on track and being openly honest. I'm interpreting that as not sheltering or not conforming our language just to minimize it, but to actually have true conversations. Angel Jennings, an open line of communication, listen with ears. And I'm not ready to just cut me off when we are communicating. And then Ashley, I speak for all parents. Your honesty is appreciated. Tone is important and trusting you to take the things we have taught you and the values that have been instilled to apply them to everyday scenarios. I couldn't have said it better, Ashley.
Yeah, that was excellent. Thank you. So that is the end of their questions and end of our questions tonight. Sybil and Corey, I'm going to ask you, since we are kind of at time, I'm going to ask you to give a one sentence piece of advice before we take off for the night.
Vulnerability begets vulnerability. So be vulnerable with your kids, they're more likely to be vulnerable with you.
Corey, I like that one.
That was good.
I think lasting impression for me tonight as a parent is, in order to receive trust, we've got to give trust. And so no judgment zone, honest and open, and willing to be, as Corey said, vulnerable.
Thank you. And it looks like we got one more comment in the chat. Parents can start with both the good and bad that comes with relationships and your viewpoints. Excellent. Listen to understand and not reply. Yes. Oh my goodness. I teach people this all the time. Don't start thinking about your reply before they're done talking. Excellent. This has been an excellent conversation tonight, everybody. I want to thank you all so much for joining us. I want to thank our panelists for being so open and honest and vulnerable with us tonight. I hope everybody has a great evening. And check out the recording on our social media within the next day or so. Thank you and good night to everybody.
Good night, everybody.
Good night, guys.
Hi, guys.